Hi, this is Remembering the Past with Corey Franklin, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start out with a scientist. We're going to start out with Andrew Huxley, who died recently at the age of 94. Andrew Huxley made one of the groundbreaking discoveries of medicine and physiology in the 20th century. He discovered how nerve impulses are transmitted, which essentially means how we touch, how we feel, how we sense, how we hear, how we taste, and how we move. For his work in how nerve impulses are transmitted, Andrew Huxley won the 1963 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine, along with his collaborators Alan Hodgkins of Britain and John Eccles of Australia. Andrew Huxley was from the famous Huxley family in Britain. His grandfather was Thomas Huxley, the great 19th century biologist and proponent of evolution, and his two half-brothers were Julian Huxley, who was a pioneer in the field of animal behavior, and Aldous Huxley, who wrote Brave New World. Andrew Huxley went to Cambridge University, and after World War II, he became involved in physiology. He became interested in explaining the phenomenon that Luigi Galvani had discovered in the 18th century of how nerve impulses are transmitted, and so he began work that way. It was understood to be some sort of electrical phenomenon, but the exact mechanism was unclear. Hodgkin and Huxley started working with the squid because the squid has the longest nerve cell of any animal. It's large, and because of its size and length, it was easier to study. And what they found was the electrical phenomenon was based on the fact that the outside of the nerve cell and the inside of the nerve cell had different electrical potentials. And the electrical potentials were due to the amount of sodium that was concentrated outside the nerve cell, which made it electrically positive compared to the inside of the nerve cell. Inside of the nerve cell, there was more potassium. Outside, there was more sodium. But the sodium concentration was higher outside, so it was positive compared to the inside of the cell, which was negative. This chemical grading was probably an evolutionary phenomenon, which stemmed from the fact that we all came from seawater, which was primarily sodium. In any event, what Huxley and Hodgkin determined was that when the nerve was stimulated, the nerve cell wall would open up and sodium would rush into the cell, rendering it no longer positive to the inside of the cell. Potassium would rush outside in a sort of a gate mechanism. The cell wall acted as a gate. And this rushing in of sodium and out of potassium changed the electrical current in the cell, and it almost instantaneously moved down the cell to the next cell, and this was how nerve cell impulses were transmitted. It was called an action potential, and basically every biochemistry student, every medical student, every physiology student studies the concept of the action potential and how nerve cell propagation occurs based on the rushing in of sodium into the cell and the pumping out of potassium and the almost immediate restoration of this chemical and electrical equilibrium. I know it sounds complicated, but Huxley and Hodgkin actually described it in a quite simple way. And here near the end of his life, he describes how they discovered the phenomena.
Well, that enabled us to record the impulse from the inside of the squid fiber without distortion, and when we put it down first, we recorded the resting potential. It was already well known since the 19th century that the insides of nerves and muscle fibers are electrically negative to the outside, but the actual value of the negativity was not known. But we found that it was, in these damaged fibers, it was about 50 millivolts negative inside. But when we stimulated the fiber at one end and an action potential went past the tip of this electrode, it didn't merely come up toward the potential of the external fluid, which was what all the textbooks told us at the time, but it went very substantially positive. And we published this in a short note in Nature describing the observation, and but with no discussion and no conclusions.
When was this? When did you
publish it? Well, this was right at the beginning of the war. I think it was in October 39. And we had no explanation for the for this overshoot, for the inside going actually positive during the impulse. And during the war, Alan Hodgkin and I met and speculated about what the mechanism of this was. And we published a paper, a full-length paper, in the Journal of Physiology in 1945, in which we put forward four possible explanations, all of which turned out to be wrong. And with hindsight, I was reminded of a thing that my grandfather, T.H. Huxley, said when he first made himself master of the central idea of the origin of species. His response was, "How stupid not to have thought of that." And well, the explanation for this overshoot is in fact very simple. It was known from beautiful experiments by K.C. Cole before the war, measuring the impedance of the membrane at a range of high frequencies. It was known that the membrane had this very high capacitance and that the resistance of the membrane fell to a very low value when an impulse went along. It had become permeable to ions. And with hindsight, it was very stupid of us not to realize that this high permeability is in fact specific for sodium ions. Sodium ions are much more concentrated outside the fiber than inside, so they diffuse in during the action potential, carrying their positive charge and making it go positive.
Andrew Huxley was a very modest man who illustrated the precept that the most brilliant discoveries are often the simplest. And again, his discovery, which won him the Nobel Prize, is one of the basic principles of biology, physiology, and medicine today. It explains not only the nervous system, but how anesthesia works, and we have much to thank Andrew Huxley for. Tens of thousands of students study his work every year, and not one in 10,000 knows who Andrew Huxley is, and that's one of the reasons we do this program. We're going to move on briefly to Bob Welch. Bob Welch died recently at the age of 66, and for a while he was a member of Fleetwood Mac, the British blues rock band that started in the 60s. But became an international phenomenon in the 70s. Fleetwood Mac was founded by Mick Fleetwood. It included the superstars Lindsey Buckingham, Christine McVie, and Stevie Nicks. And for a while, Bob Welch played with them. He composed some of their songs. He was one of their guitarists. Interestingly, he became their guitarist when one of their other guitarists said he was going out for a pack of cigarettes and some food, and he left to join a cult and he never came back. So Bob Welch joined the group for a couple of years, but it was a pretty tempestuous relationship. He left the group in a tiff. He was not inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with them, but he went out on his own and he became famous for two compositions, one of which he used with Fleetwood Mac, but he made them both into singles and he gets a mention just for those two singles. So here are Bob Welch's two great singles after he left Fleetwood Mac, which was always involved in a lot of drugs and sex and all sorts of scandals and everything like that. And he was probably better off leaving the group. Both of these became pretty major hits for Bob Welch in the late 70s. The first is Sentimental Lady. He originally did this as part of Fleetwood Mac, but he did a better job of this on his own. 14 jars and fruit and berry, all of the things that they say are every sentimental. His other major 70s hit was a bit of a rocker, and it still sounds good today. Turn up the volume on this one. It's called Ebony Eyes. Thank you. We're going to close tonight with another rock and roller of an earlier generation, a generation before that, Herb Reed, who died recently at the age of 83. And Herb Reed was a groundbreaker. He was one of the founders, one of the original members, and the only member who lasted for the entire career of the Platters. And the Platters were the first great black rock and roll group of the 1950s. They were probably the greatest black and rock and roll group of the 1950s, and they were important in the integration of music. You know, the civil rights movement wasn't one movement. You had Jackie Robinson in baseball. You had President Truman desegregating the military. You had Brown versus Board of Education, which we talked about with Nicholas Katzenbach. You had James Meredith going to the University of Mississippi. And with rock and roll, you had Little Richard and Chuck Berry. But the first great black group of the early 1950s, and they went through the whole 1950s, were the Platters. They were actually named by Herb Reed. He called them the Platters because a platter was what the disc jockeys called the records back in those days. And in 1954, they picked up a female member also. So that they were not only the first great black group, but they were the first group that was male and female together. Herb Reed was born in Kansas City and moved out to Los Angeles during World War II. He picked up a couple of doo-wop singers. They were actually before the doo-wop craze actually caught on in the late 50s, and they sang mostly 40 standards. Then, through their manager, Buck Ram, a white guy, they got a string of big hits and became one of the biggest groups of the 1950s. In every nostalgia program and in every nostalgia movie, you're going to hear songs from the Platters. Here are a couple of the Platters' greatest hits. Now, you're not going to hear too much of Herb Reed on these because he was their bass. And the great voice of the Platters, one of the great voices in rock and roll history, was that of Tony Williams. So he's singing these songs with Herb Reed as the bass. Every one of these is familiar to anybody who listens to old-time rock and roll. Here's Only You.
Only
here's another classic, Twilight Time.
Heavenly shades of night are falling. It's twilight time.
Here's a Jerome Kern classic from the 30s that they made into a 50s standard. Smoke Gets in Your Eyes.
They said someday you'll find all who love are blind.
And what may be the definitive Platters record, The Great Pretender. Herb Reed was very proud of the Platters. They had a lot of problems in the late 50s, early 60s. Tony Williams left the group. Herb Reed tried to keep the group going, and he did throughout all these years. As with many of these old black groups, there were legal batters over who were the real Platters and who were the original Platters and all that stuff. And Herb Reed went to court to fight to protect his ownership of the Platters name after all the other members left. And he actually won the lawsuit a couple years ago. Here he talks about his experience with the Platters, and you can tell how proud he is. He's in his 80s when he gives this interview.
Recall a long-forgotten era. Since the mid-50s, the lineups have changed countless times. Although the last original member, Herb Reed, is more an overseer than a full-blown singer today, he still carries the torch in the group's current incarnation.
Why the Platters?
Because the disc jockeys used to refer to records as being Platters. So we were all individual singers. So I said, well, he's a Platter, I'm a Platter, she's a Platter, you know, and that's why I gave up the name the Platters. But nobody liked it. I mean,
originally from Kansas City, Missouri, Reed was paying the rent as a gas station attendant in Los Angeles when he was asked to join. The group was originally comprised of four men. They added a 15-year-old woman, Zola Taylor, in 1954 to broaden their appeal.
When we went to see Buck Brown for the first time, he suggested, you know, we'd have to have something like in the way of, you know, to showcase ourselves or a gimmick or something. And he suggested a girl.
All who love are blind.
quivering tenor Tony Williams was the voice of the group. Manager Buck Graham was the brains, writing and producing classics such as Only You, The Magic Touch, The Great Pretender, and Twilight Time.
I'm the great pretender.
When in that recording studio, did any of those say to you, this is going to be a winner?
No, not a one.
Really?
Not one song. We didn't think about that at all. We just didn't think about, it's going to be a hit, it's not going to be a hit.
Over the years, key members left or tried to use the Platters' name in spin-off groups, causing legal battles. Reed himself left in 1969, but later brought together various lineups and now leads a group he considers the one and only.
You're going to hear the Platters, not anybody imitating, but you hear the Platters, because, you know, we worked hard at getting that right, sound just right.
Your trivia question for the week is that Zola Taylor, the female member of the Platters, was one of the women who claimed to be Frankie Lyman's wife in that big tussle over Frankie Lyman's estate. Frankie Lyman from Why Do Fools Fall in Love, Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers, who we've talked about before. In any event, Herb Reed was a major figure in the Platters. The Platters were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1990. He was a major figure not only in early rock and roll crossover, but he was also a major figure in integration in the United States after World War II. His name isn't well known, but his legacy is significant. Well, we're going to close on that note tonight. I'd like to thank my producer, Sid Tepps, and we're going to close with a Platters record. We're going to close with my favorite Platters record, and coincidentally, it happens to be the one where you can actually hear Herb Reed's bass. It's called You'll Never Know, and you get a good taste of Herb Reed on this record. And again, I think this is the Platters' best record. In tribute to Herb Reed, You'll Never Know.
You'll never know.
Or else you'll never. No, you'll never.